Three lines on a shirt. Jewels, roommates still gleaming. 30 years of hurt. Never stop me dreaming. It's coming home, it's coming. Football's coming home. It's coming home, it's coming home, it's coming. Football's coming home. Woo! Welcome to the Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 81, with me, your host, Agostinho, and I'm excited! Oh, shit, man. Fuck. Now people realize why I love or people like me or other human beings who enjoy the lovely game that we call football. Now you understand why, right? Wow, man. England have had an amazing World Cup run. We're into the quarterfinals. I mean, the semifinals. See, my brain's all frazzled. The semifinals of the World Cup 2018 in Russia against Croatia. This match happened over the weekend and I'm still buzzing now. I'm still excited, right? That's what football does to you. It puts you in a good mood, right? I support Manchester United. We've had some very troubling years ever since Ferguson has retired. And there's been some weekends where I've just not wanted to talk to anyone, right? Or there's been some week when I've watched football during the weekend, I've had work on the week. It's just been, it made the week incredibly slow, right? I didn't want to check Sky Sports News. I wasn't checking ESPN. I wasn't checking Bleacher Report. I was just avoiding everything. But when it goes right for you, when the result's amazing, you're jumping, man. You're skipping all over the floor and shit, do you know what I mean? You're calling friends that you don't usually speak to and telling them the good news that it's coming home, it's coming. Football's coming home. Mate, how pumped and how hype is the nation right now, man? Like, now we kind of... It's so weird how something as surface level as a bunch of men kicking a bag of wind around in the pitch can somehow unify a whole nation. Because if you're all familiar with England, or if you're at all familiar with the politics to do with the St. George flag, you'd know that there's a lot of weird shit happening in the background or on the ground in the real world when it comes to supporting England, right? It's not as easy as it seems to other people. So sometimes when you see all this hype and you see all this jubilation regarding England making their way to semifinals, think how far we've come, man. From the BNP to the EDL to all that UKIP shit, with guys like Tommy Robinson when he used to be in the EDL, right? Think about where we've come from, man. And look at us now, where we're all jumping around supporting this, this great England team, right? There might not be an England team full of great individuals, but they're a great England team altogether. There's no real standout, I don't know. You're giving him a disservice, but you know, it's not like it was in the past. We haven't got these like world class players who everyone is thinking we should be playing in the final. Everyone kind of had like took a bit of a backseat approach with this England team. Like, you know what? Let them just make a good showing and let them kind of represent us and kind of do themselves justice, right? And they have done it. They've gone over to Russia. Yes, it does need to be said, like a bit of an asterisk on top of it. England have had a favourable run, right? Apart from all the other people that we're facing, we've gone through the fire, but we've had we've faced some easy teams. Croatia might be one of the most difficult team our first teams had to face, because we kind of saw the insufficiencies of our team overall when our second team had to face Belgium. We kind of come up short there when Januzaj scored that amazing goal, curled into the top corner. So now it's going to be a real test to see what our best 11 can do against another nation's best 11. And Croatia have shown that they're a pretty decent side, right? They've got Rebric on the right. They've got Perisic on the left. Mandzukic in the middle. Rakitic and Modric in the middle. They're very, very accomplished players. So it's going to be a very difficult game. But I don't know, man. I'm just happy overall. I don't fucking care if England end up losing 10-0 against Croatia. I'm just really happy to see finally an England team doing themselves credit and giving the nation a bit of hope. Because what this also goes to show is that even though a lot of the hype, even though a lot of the excitement from back in the day was a little bit unfounded, right? If you look at, whenever I look at England players getting interviewed, I always look at their crest. You know, they've only got one star on the top of it. So, you know, we don't have any right to be that confident. We won one World Cup in our history, right? Which is crazy considering how big and commercially successful our league is, right? And considering the money that we pour in and the players that attracts and the managers that it attracts, you'd think we'd be a lot better, right? But we're not. But for some reason, over the years, we've kind of gone into every tournament, whether it's a Euro World Cup, and we've always had this false sense of entitlement that we deserve to get out of the group. We deserve to get into a knockout stage. We deserve to get into the latter rounds. And I never really saw why that was a thing, you know, considering how good other nations were during that time. You know, you had the great Brazil team with the triple R's at the front. You had the France team with Zidane, Henri, Trezeguet, all that malarkey. You had the legendary Spain team with Raul playing up front. So there was a lot of teams out there that who are doing really, really amazing things and who seemed, you know, leaps and bounds above what England were doing. Plus, when you factor in the fact that, you know, we hadn't really addressed the situation of why England were failing, right? It was more of a root and stem analysis, whereas everyone else in the country or most people wanted to just, you know, chop off the branches and replace that so-and-so person, play different formation. But the actual point of the whole thing was that from the under-10s upwards, the English football academy system is a bit fucked up. You know, you got kids such as Loftus Creek, who's at 23 or something like that, right? Who hasn't met, I don't think he's played more than 40 Premier League games, which is horrible if you think about someone of his talent, right? That goes to show that players who aren't necessarily Jack Wilshere, or who haven't got that kind of profile, who are kind of the level of below, not Loftus Creek isn't a bad player, but a player like Loftus Cheek should be playing for a top six side week in, week out, which will then allow him to be maybe a candidate for a side like England. But in years gone by, that wasn't always the case. So you had to always pick from a very small and concentrated pool. But then that small and concentrated pool wasn't necessarily a great fit for a team, right? So you had that whole thing of like forcing, trying to shoehorn Scholes, Lampard and Gerrard all into one midfield, which probably isn't the best way to go about things. Anyway, long story short, it seems as if we've now seen that even though the hype before was unjustified, I get it, right? I think people were looking at the lineup that we had on paper and thinking we have to win, right? Looking at Ashley Cole, Gary Neville, Adams, Sol Campbell, Terry in his heyday, right? David Seaman, Beckham, Rooney. This is young Rooney, right? Everyone's looking at that kind of lineup and thinking we should be winning. So I don't really blame them for the most part for getting a bit too hype. But now we've seen with this team or with this England side that it necessarily isn't about having the best players in each position play for England, right? It's not, but like I said, I'll repeat it again. It's not about having the best players in each position playing for England. It's about having the best players in each position that work best for the team overall. For instance, Ashley Young is a good example of it, right? He might necessarily be the best left. No one's saying he's the best left back in England or the best left wing back in England. No one would ever doubt that, right? But for this team and for the way they play, he probably is the best fit at the moment. And considering what's currently available, he probably is the best fit. Same with Jordan Henderson, right? Someone who a lot of people didn't really rate to begin with, but he's kind of improved his game a lot. His passing ability is a lot better than what I assumed it to be. It's still probably not as good as it should be for that level, but it's as good as he's going to be able to make it, right? Because, again, I'm a big believer in focusing on his strengths. So if Jordan Henderson, his strengths is having a really good engine and great cardio and great at tackling, great at kind of keeping the shape of the midfield, then he should concentrate on enhancing those skills as opposed to trying to become Pirlo overnight, because that's not going to happen. But you can see someone like Kim fits better in the midfield than, I don't know, picking an outright talented player who's like a better on paper sort of FIFA stats player. And I'm hoping, regardless of what happens against Croatia, I'm hoping this continues with our next squads, our next tournaments that we have, especially with Gareth Southgate. Maybe that's going to help because he does want to, it seems as if he does want to kind of raise his profile and he does want to kind of be regarded as maybe a manager who was responsible for dragging England into the modern age, right? So like a Joachim Loeb in that respect, right? Kind of revolutionizing the way we go about treating international football. I'm hoping in tournaments that to come that we kind of have the same template and do the same thing, because it's been amazing, man. It's been so much fun to watch an England side playing with freedom but also playing with control, right? The possession-based football hasn't been just possession for the sake of it. It's been possession because everyone is more comfortable doing that, and they all realize that when you're playing on the world stage, against these nations, regardless of how shit they may be, they're still the best players from their country. So if you give them an opportunity to score, they will score. So keeping the ball, retaining the ball in some regard, and also punishing them with the ball is a way that you win games. And you're seeing a lot of that. You're seeing Pickford, who's also doing really well, and he kind of, you know, he looks a bit out of place in the modern age of football, of goalkeepers, right? You look at kind of Alisson for Brazil. That's kind of the usual physique that a lot of goalkeepers have. Even De Gea is probably a little bit slight for a goalkeeper nowadays, but that's the kind of physique of the goalkeeper that are coming out. You look at Donnarumma at AC Milan, the same sort of physique, right? Really tall, really built kind of striker. Sort of like a Harry Maguire in goal. That's the sort of physique that everyone kind of is kind of going for goalkeepers. But Jordan Pickford is a bit of a throwback, right? He's really small, really agile, and he's done a really amazing job. You can see why he's got picked too. He's very good with the ball at his feet, a lot better than I thought he would be. And it also goes to show that a lot of these keepers, especially the ones that play for the lower sides, right? The sides that concede a lot of goals, like the Everton's in that regard, right? It sometimes can be a bit unfair to judge him on just what he does with Everton, because when you're playing in front of that, when you're playing behind a defence such as Everton, it's a bit difficult to keep goals out, you know? You're playing behind an age Jagielka, and who's the other mixed race dude from Swansea who always gives away penalties? Like, there's a couple of defenders that they've got there who are just, you know what I mean, ridiculously shit. In front of them, you've still got who's a player for United that went there a while back? You just got shit midfield overall, right? You got Wayne Rooney was playing midfield for a little bit. Now he's gone to DC United. So I'm hoping, I'm praying and hoping that this continues and we see the same thing happening in the future. And you know what this is gonna do as well? This is gonna give Southgate an interesting selection headache for any future tournaments. I bet you loads of players who are necessarily weren't that hype about playing for England are going to make themselves available again. I bet you. I fucking bet you. I bet you 100%. And that's going to be great to see these players that come out, you know, and kind of make themselves available for the nation going forward. And I think this is how it should be, man, considering how popular the league is, man. Like, England should be getting out of the group stages and at least getting to the quarterfinals. That should be standard, man. You know what I mean? The Premier League is one of the biggest leagues in the world. Like, it might not be the best quality football, but commercially and considering the money they generate, like I mentioned before, that attracts big managers, that attracts big players, they should be getting at least to the semis. No, sorry, at least to the quarterfinals, I think, in most cases. And considering the run that England have had, it's great too. And like I said, it's just amazing to be in a pub full of British people, English people, and be celebrating England playing. Because I remember years gone by, I wouldn't even go to a pub to watch England. I can't remember the last time. Actually, I can remember the last time I went to watch England in a bar or a pub was in Shoreditch, which wasn't really a bar or a pub. It's sort of like a trendy place. And I went to watch England v Germany. You remember that first Germany game where we kind of got introduced to Ozil and everyone, right? So when that crop first came about and they battered us 4-1, I think, and Lampard scored the goal at the end when they hit the crossbar, whatever the line. That was probably the last England game I ever watched, and that was depressing as fuck because we got played off the park completely. And that was the England side again, containing the Lampards, the Gerrards, all the big ticket players, and it just came up ridiculously short against a very young and dare I say, unknown Germany team. So it's good to kind of fast forward now and be in a pub now in Stratford, surrounded by real English people, you know, some of who might harbour some resentment for the colour of my skin. But in that one moment, you know, where Harry Maguire scores a goal or Dele Alli bangs it in, we're all kind of jumping around, spinning around and singing, "It's coming home, it's coming home." But you did see, the couple of times I was jumping around, I did see a couple of whiteys. It's fun to say white, isn't it? Because when people say the blacks as well, it always sounds super weird, isn't it? The blacks, black people. But I did see a couple of English people in the pub give me not a weird look, but like kind of like, interesting. You know what I mean? Like, just like, because I'm sure it's as surprising as it is for me to be in there celebrating with them, it's surprising for them that I'm actually in there. So that was something that was interesting, and I found, I don't know, I just find it cool, man. I find it amazing. I find it lovely. It's considering how much stick this World Cup got beforehand from all the politically correct journalists out there. It goes to show that when it comes to sports and football, when it comes to sports in general, no one gives a shit about politics. You can host a World Cup in North Korea and it'll be an absolute blast, I reckon. People don't care. People just want an escape. They want to have one time in their life where they're not have, you know, nothing's politically motivated. We can just go and enjoy themselves, you know? Like, you're seeing loads of videos of opposing fans jumping up and celebrating with each other. You're seeing videos of fans such as Japanese and Senegalese cleaning up their stands after a game. You're just seeing a lot of camaraderie, you know, a lot of good graces. And it just goes to show that not everything is politically motivated. And even when you try to make it politically motivated, some people are just going to be like, you know what? Nah, I'm gonna pass on that one. I like the football instead. So, yeah. Fucking come on, England. Game's happening on what? Where? Thursday? When? No, Wednesday, sorry. Cannot fucking wait. Absolutely cannot wait. Should be an occasion, at least, anyway. Let's see what happens going forward. What else should we speak about here? Back on the docky. Oh, you know what? Before we get into anything else, congratulations to Justin Bieber and Hailey fucking Baldwin, right? I just saw this news recently, just now, actually, just when I came back from the gym. I went to do a quick little pump, as you can tell. Pump time. Oh, today's workout was fucking brutal. Like, 5 rounds. It's on CrossFit.com, actually. 5 rounds of five deadlifts and 10 burpees. Absolutely brutal. Ended up doing that in about 4 minutes, 50-something. So that was quite good. Happy with the pace. But then I jumped on my Twitter as I was coming back home. And I saw the news that Justin Bieber and Hailey Baldwin have been engaged. I'm not sure how long they've been together, judging by social media, not so long, because I only saw pictures of them popping up recently, but it's cute, isn't it? I just think it's nice. I thought this picture was really nice that I saw. Obviously, Hailey Baldwin wearing her nice little ring. Justin there chilling. It's a really nice picture. They seem in love. You know, they seem happy. And Justin posted a little message on, is it Instagram or Twitter? It looks like Twitter. And that was really... You can tell the guy has changed, though, right? Because the whole thing happened when he stopped the tour and he then started hanging around with that that preacher. I forgot his name. Who's is it Hillsong Church he's a leader of? One of those churches, anyway. The guy that kind of wears, like, Saint Laurent boots and, like, Fear of God jeans and metal T-shirts cut off with his arms showing and shit. So he kind of looks, you know, a little bit like a hipster or whatever. So he hangs around this guy a lot, and people have, like, you know, their suspicions about that dude. But for the most part, it seems as if this guy has plugged him, this preacher dude, I've got his name, has plugged himself into the Hollywood celebrity circuit. And it seems like he's doing more good than harm. It seems like everyone he's sort of touched in some way, shape, or form has kind of calmed down. And Justin Bieber was probably the most, he's probably at his most craziest when he probably met that dude, right? Do you remember this was the time when he was hanging around that little twist dude, right? The time when he was that stripper or whatever model in Brazil, took a video of him when he was sleeping in a bed after they smashed during the Brazilian carnival. This is when Justin Bieber was at his fucking peak. So he kind of came at a good time for Justin, and it seems if he's in a good space. But the message... Because I remember after he finished, I think everyone was saying that maybe he's retired from music or he's taking a break. But the message sounds like someone that's giving themselves to Christ or giving their life to Christ. It does sound very Christ-like, because this sounds like something my mum would say. So he writes, was going to wait a while to say anything, but word travels fast. Listen plain and simple. Hayley and I, I'm so, it's a weird sentence, isn't it? Was going to wait a while to say anything, but word travels fast. Listen plain and simple. Hayley. I'm so in love with everything about you. So committed to spending my life getting to know every single part of you and loving you patiently and kindly. I promise to lead our family with honor and integrity into Jesus. Letting Jesus through this, his Holy Spirit guide us in everything we do and every decision we make. My heart is completely and fully yours, and I will always put you first. You are the love of my life, Hailey Baldwin, and I wouldn't want to spend it with anyone else. You make me so much better, and we complement each other so well. Can't wait for the best season of life to yet. It's funny because now with you, everything seems to make sense. The thing I'm most excited for is that my little brother and sister get to see another healthy, stable marriage and look for the same. God's timing really is literally perfect. That's fucking sweet, isn't it, right? Like, and I fucking hate love, right? I'm a fucking hate fucking love. Hating people are really in love and committed to their relationship. It just winds me up the wrong way. But it's great to see someone like him, like fucking Justin, right? Someone who probably had fame way too early, right? But was able somehow to keep his sanity, right? I don't know how he did it. Maybe he didn't keep his sanity and he did go nuts, but we didn't see. But he's able to keep his sanity for the most part. He was involved in some outlandish things. You know that time when he came out of his room, his villa somewhere? It wasn't his fault because the fucking paparazzi had some fucking massive telescopic zoom on. when he came out of his room, like, fully Starkers, and everyone got to see that he had a fucking piece on him, right? Like, Justin wasn't playing no games. But for the most part, he's handled everything all right, I think. He's been fairly stable. And it's good to see someone like that finally find happiness in some respect, right? It looks like, because he looks like a kind of guy who likes having girlfriends, right? He's always in relationship with someone, it seems like. And it's good to see him finally find a girlfriend who makes him happy. And Hailey looks happy. They both look happy. So, yeah, I'm happy for them, man. Why wouldn't you? It's nice to see. Hopefully, you know, I'm sure there's some cynical lots out there kind of, you know, saying, ah, it's not going to last. It's not going to be a long thing. But, you know, shut the fuck up, man. Let them enjoy themselves. It's a good thing. And it's just good to see, you know, maybe for us as well, in the public eye, even though I'm a, I dissuade people in general from looking at celebrities as any sort of bastion of moral superiority or a gauge, you know, in order to kind of judge how far you are in life. It's good to see someone that you maybe look up to. You, not me, because I'm like, let him do his life. It's good to see someone you look up to, you know, be in a committed relationship, you know, a relationship based on faith in that regard too, which is a kind of taboo nowadays, right? No one really, you don't really hear people talking about their faith in relationship that much, you know, or just in general, like, oh, let God bless us and all this sort of shit. It's a very, it seems very old fashioned, doesn't it? Him, the way they're kind of approaching things, which is, you know, which is great. I'm not opposed to it, but you don't really see people saying that nowadays. Everyone's trying to, you know, tear up the fucking Bible and insert their own little postmodernist kind of view and slant on figures. So, but it's good to see someone like Justin, who probably has all the options in the world, commit himself to a committed relationship, basically, you know, tie himself down, and hopefully they wed soon and they have a good life and have plenty of kids and continue their lovely marriage together. But yeah, that was nice. I saw that and I thought, you know what, that's fucking lovely. Anyway, onto the normal stuff, away from the fucking TMZ fucking articles, right? Who fucking wants to care about that? But, yeah. So, here we go. Number one, a bit of sad news I saw on the internet the other day. I'm not sure if you guys are aware, but there's a YouTube channel called High on Life that I used to check quite often, actually. Did I check quite often? Yeah, I used to check it quite often. Before I went to Nicaragua, so I went to... a friend of mine was volunteering or working at Nicaragua for a few years ago, actually, right? She went out and worked there for a bit. And I was sort of like in a weird stage and also in a weird point of life where I kind of wasn't sure what I wanted to do. The whole uni thing didn't really work out. I wasn't happy living at home. Me and my parents were having a lot of problems, butting heads, blah, 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 blah. But I just kind of, I felt a bit stuck. You know, in your life where you just feel like things... You just feel as if like you just can't, you're stuck in mud, right? So I thought the best thing to do at that point, especially since I think that was a point when I started to listen to people like Tim Ferriss and all that kind of stuff. I started to get into the idea of traveling and I read, I forgot what the book's called. What's the book called? A book by Rolf Potts. He was on a Tim Ferriss podcast too. I read his book. Vagabonding, that's the one. I read a book called Vagabonding by Rolf Potts, which he's also been a guest on Tim Ferriss's web podcast. I would definitely recommend you check it out. But it's this book here called Vagabonding. Let me give it a clicky on the Amazon so you guys can see. But I highly recommend if you're a traveler such as I am, or you know, pretend traveling in Malakia, I definitely recommend you check this out. Vagabonding, an uncommon guide to the art of long-term travel by Rolf Potts. And Rolf is spelled R-O-L-F, Potts spelled P-O-T-T-S. And this book is amazing because it really does, it kind of gives you a blueprint or an instruction manual on how to travel the right way, in terms of, you know, disconnecting from the internet, in terms of saving up before you go on holiday, like the idea of earning the holiday, like earning your keep, like doing what you can, doing whatever it takes for you to get that trip in, right? And it says the idea of like traveling long term is more than 4 weeks. Loads of really interesting little tidbits that he mentions in the book. But anyway, long story short, that's someone I was looking up to, and I kind of used that book as a kind of template for when I went traveling to Nicaragua and through other parts of Central America. Then during the same time, I also stumbled upon this YouTube channel called High on Life. That was an amazing YouTube channel that kind of profiled these group of friends who kind of went around the world traveling, like, and kind of, you know, in all these different exotic locations. This is also the time when the whole selfie stick movement was coming up, when GoPros were really big on YouTube. Remember, everyone was kind of, you'd be watching people. I'm not sure people are doing the same thing now, watching travel vloggers, because that was a really big thing before, like doing, especially the ones that did like city guys, or people that did beach guys, or people that did like, I don't know, just exposing the other side of traveling, because you watch stuff like the Travel Channel and stuff, and they don't necessarily have the kind of traveling that we might be interested in, like the more authentic side of it, you know, kind of living like a local or doing as locals do. And then I kind of stopped watching it for a little bit because I kind of went off it. But I saw this news come up on my feed and I was super bummed out that three people from High on Life unfortunately passed away when they were traveling somewhere. I think in America, was it British Columbia or something? So the article is here. I'm probably going to get up on the website. So three travelers, three of the guys from the High on Life team, unfortunately died. Megan Scraper, Rika Gamble, and Alexi Leica. So basically, the girl who's the girlfriend of this guy, she kind of fell into the lake, and then these two guys went to go and save her, and they all three of them drowned. And yeah, it's just such a sad story, man. And I don't know, man. Like, I'm sure what lessons can be gleaned from this. I think it's maybe there's something to be said for, you know, those guys in the Russia that do all those high risk sort of like walking on beams and going on top of fucking buildings and hanging off of it and shit, right? You're doing stuff for likes, which is kind of a little bit silly. And maybe you can criticize High Life guys for kind of doing the same thing, right? Going up on the highest point of a mountain somewhere, or highest point of a waterfall, and then filming it. But then, you know, if you fall down, you're fucked. But there's also a part of me that kind of thinks, you know, like, they went out doing something that they loved. Yes, the final moments were probably really scary, you know, when the girl, when Megan kind of fell in, and both dudes tried to, or I'd imagine Megan fell in, the boyfriend went to go jump after her, and then the friend saw the boyfriend jumping after the girlfriend, and then he went to jump in as well. Maybe their last moments weren't the best, but I think the idea of, like, you know, where, what, because, you know, the end is going to come for all of us, right? We're all going to die at some point. So I'd much rather go out on my feet doing something that I love than go out, you know, doing something that I hate, right? The kind of nightmare would be kind of dying in your chair whilst you're working in a job that you don't really care for, or dying sitting down at a bus stop waiting to go somewhere that you didn't really want to go to, but you were kind of obliged to go to, you know, those kind of things. So the fact that they kind of, you know, passed away doing something that they kind of love is maybe the only consolation you can kind of glean from this. But it was incredibly sad to see. And yeah, man, it kind of did take me back a bit. It's weird, man, because when it comes to death and all that sort of shit, I don't necessarily get that caught up about it in general. But I think maybe sometimes when you follow these people and you watch their vlogs on YouTube, or you follow them on Instagram or in other forms of social media, Facebook, Twitter and stuff, you kind of do feel like you know them, even though you probably don't. But the fact that you're looking at them every single day, you're clicking on their comments, you're looking at the people they follow and shit, you kind of feel like you're invested in them. So when you find out something happened to them, you kind of feel a little bit bummed out. And yeah, it kind of did bum me out a bit, man. It kind of did bum me out, I'm not going to lie. And then the other part of the story that makes it even worse is that I've heard, or I've seen on the internet, that there's been a bit of backlash because I think they've put up a GoFundMe for some of them, or one of the girls, to support them for their funeral costs, right? And some fans of High on Life are sort of complaining, saying that why should they be asking for money if they, you know, these big influencers who are able to travel the world and were invited to different resorts, who had fully comped flights and shit. And it does maybe raise up an interesting question, right? About how much, it does raise up an interesting question around perception when it comes to influencers, because I think for the most part, a lot of people have this kind of thing misconstrued, right? So if you think an influencer is cash rich, then you're insanely wrong. I guess for the most part, when you're an influencer, the whole point of the debate you've seen online sometimes with influencers saying a lot of brands exploit them and only offer them products, or offer them exposure, is that that doesn't translate to money spent. So imagine if like you're being invited to Coachella, right? And you're not being given, and you've been given free tickets, but you've not been given any money. You've been invited to Coachella, even though you got VIP tickets to go to Coachella, you still have to get yourself there. You still have to find accommodation. You still have to pay for your food. Whoever friend you're inviting, that might be times two. Whatever production cost it takes to, you know, make good footage, whether it be getting some amazing outfits, whatever it may be, it kind of adds up. So if anything, even though the tickets are free, it's still a lot of money, right? So sometimes I think it's good to know that as well these influencers are doing, it's less about being cash rich. It's less about being cash rich and more so about living a life where you don't have a boss. Living a life where you get to do exactly what you want to do and work with the brands that you know and love, right? That's probably where the sense of richness comes from. But then sometimes when there is an emergency, such as, you know, someone's got funeral costs to cover and stuff, you can panic a bit and think, you know what, fuck, I don't actually have any actual money to get this done. And I don't think, and I also think maybe it's disingenuous to some people, but I think for all the value that High Life have given you over the years, right? I think they do sell merch. I'm pretty sure they sell merch, but for the value they've given you over the year, free content over the years, right? If someone from the team perishes or needs help with medical costs and stuff, I think as fans, or I think as people that are into what they do, I don't think it's any skin of our nose to donate a couple of bucks, right? That's the least you can do. And that's where I understand why Patreon comes in, where places like that work really well, because I think there is a real misconception behind what some of these influencers are actually making. And there is misconception because I think if you're looking at it through that lens, you're doing it the wrong way. Being an influencer isn't about being a multimillionaire. Being an influencer is about having time to do the things that you love and enjoy, right? I had an idea this summer that I wanted to do a bit of an influencer tour, right? I wanted to go to Paris Fashion Week to potentially try and bum rush the Louis Vuitton show, maybe attend some after parties. I wanted to maybe go to Art Miami Basel, right? Do these other things. But then I quickly realized that when you work a full-time job and you have an allotted amount of holiday time, there's only so much time you can take off work, right, to make it viable. And then even then, you're having to pay a lot of money to go to these kind of places, blah, 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 blah. So what that makes you realize is that even though these things are going to cost you money to go to, there might be opportunities on the other side, you never know, or it might be exposure, you never know, whatever it is, but you just kind of go into it because you kind of just want to be there, right? Especially after reading Holy Terror, the book that kind of is an expose on Andy Warhol's life from start to finish, written by one of his close friends, Beck Costello. It's called Holy Terror, anyway, you can find it on Amazon. Having read a book like that, you quickly realize that it's less about the money you make and more so about being there whilst history is being made, right? So imagine the Louis Vuitton, the first Virgil show for Louis Vuitton, right, in Paris. Even if I don't get into the fucking show, right, the fact that I'm in Paris watching it, or the fact that I'm in Paris hanging around that ambience, right, that's about being there. I was there when that thing happened, right, crossing paths with certain individual, blah, 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 blah. That's what it's about. So sometimes, even though you might think, okay, even though a lot of people, a lot of kids out there want to be influencers and stuff, I think you might have to kind of realign your priorities and realize that when you are an influencer, it's about having the time to do the things that you love and enjoy, and it's less about being a millionaire. If you want to be a millionaire, get into another business. But I don't know, I just thought it was a bit sad, you know, like for all the benefit they've given us over the years. Like, I've watched so many of their videos, and I stumbled on an article online about it saying, you know, some fans were outraged that these guys are asking for money because, you know, they're such big influencers, why does she be asking for money? It's like, dude, so three people died in their group, three, right? I don't know, I've heard from people that funerals cost a lot more money than you think they do, right? It's all like washing machines. It's all the thing that when it breaks, you're fucking pissed because, you know, you can't get a washing machine for 100 quid, especially a good one anyway. So yeah, that was sad. And yeah, RIP all three of those guys. And I don't know, man. I don't know what it means for High Life now, High on Life going forward now. I don't know if they're going to curb their outlandish stunts and stuff. I don't know if this kind of changes the way they this kind of, because they it did seem like they were pivoting away from the kind of crazy stunts and were kind of going back to the kind of, you know, wholesome good life sort of thing message. But I'm hoping it doesn't change. But yeah, you know, death can bring a whole different perspective on life in general. But yeah, I saw that news and I was kind of bummed out. So RIP those three from High on Life, etc. Next on the docket, you seen a story about this French gangster that escaped from jail? Man, oh fucking man. What an incredible, incredible story. So, this fucking dude, right? Rédoine Faïd, is it Faïd? Yeah. Rédoine Faïd is an incredible gentleman. So, this dude escaped, right, from prison. This young man escaped from prison. It's an amazing story, really. Or I guess amazing if you're a fan of criminals, and maybe not amazing if you're not a fan of criminals. But basically, this dude is a well-known bank robber from France. It's been said in the media that he was infatuated with the movie Heat, which I watched actually a couple of months ago. It's fucking a great movie, right? He watched it like, what, 9 times or some shit, whatever he mentioned. So he's serving a 25-year sentence for a robbery gone wrong. They're kind of notorious kind of bank thieves, or in a similar vein to the Pink Panthers, right? Which you should also check out. There's a TV series about them called The Last Panthers, which I think was on ITV a while back. I highly recommend you check it out, Last Panthers. And they're the notorious kind of jewelry heisting gang, mostly from the Eastern Bloc, right? They're mostly from like Serbia, Montenegro, and all those kind of places, right? But it's called The Last Panthers. It was on ITV a while back, but I highly recommend you check it out, right? Definitely check it out. And they're also the gang that was supposed to be responsible for robbing Kim Kardashian in Paris. So very, very well known. Anyway, long story short, Rédoine Faïd is serving a 25-year sentence, right, for a botched robbery where they tried to rob somewhere, and unfortunately one of the accomplices end up shooting a policewoman and she died. And they're obviously notoriously, they're kind of well known for not even firing a single shot, right? Just having the guns as like an intimidation tactic. So anyway, he's in prison, but before that he writes a book, he appears on TV, he's like, you know, a very well-known figure. Then he goes into prison, and for some reason, I read about it a little bit on Reddit. There's a really good thread on it on Reddit at the moment, which I've kind of got on the screen now, you guys can check out. But basically, according to the thread on Reddit, they don't search women in prisons. They don't pat them down in French prisons. And the guards inside the prison aren't armed either. So supposedly he had various women come in and visit him who hid bits and pieces of explosives in tissue boxes. And then over a period of time, he had enough to kind of put onto the walls, blast it open, and then run out and kind of escape through a getaway car. He was found 6 weeks later, but then he was put into prison again. But then this time around, they went an extra mile and they planned it a long, long, long time ahead. And what they had done beforehand was they had a drone come in and fly over the courtyard of the prison, right? Where everyone plays basketball and fucking works out and shit and does their walk, right? And they had the fucking drone float down and see and kind of feel if there was any mesh on the courtyard, because usually those kind of places have mesh so that, you know, planes can't land and shit. Or if other things can't be thrown over. So they realized that there wasn't any mesh on it. And then a few weeks later, two accomplices from his gang decided to the pilot of, there's a helicopter school somewhere near the airport, somewhere near the prison, where two of his gang member friends pretended to be a father and son team, right? One was 50, one was in his 20s. They went there and did a couple of flying lessons beforehand. Then on the day of the escape, they demanded that the helicopter guy take them in a certain helicopter. The helicopter guy declined. Then they kind of took him hostage and forced him to fly the helicopter, pick up another guy. Then they finally went to the prison. And as they went to the prison, they flew the helicopter down, blew the guy out again from the prison, and then flew out into the helicopter. Just like some fucking real life movie shit. They got the helicopter, jumped into landed it somewhere, burned it, left the guy tied up on the side of the road, the pilot, the flight instructor. Then they jumped into a getaway car, drove that somewhere else, then had that burned out, and jumped into another car. And it had that burnout too. So they're saying he might be in the wind somewhere, but it's just such an amazing story, man. To, you know, like an actual real career criminal, someone who's kind of committed themselves to this kind of life of crime. And considering how plain he looks here, right? The kind of bald hair, the thick eyebrows, he could look like, he could, I think there's theories out there that he's kind of like, you know, he's got a disguise on and shit, and he could necessarily blend in with a lot of people with that kind of, you know, just nondescript sort of like facial features and shit. So let's see what happens, but what an incredible story. I can't wait for Quentin Tarantino, one of those guys, to find this story and make something of it. But maybe some of the stories are based on these. Because there is, if you get, especially after reading Roberto Saviano's book, right? 000, and I need to read the first one too. But Gomorrah, basically, which is what the TV series, the Italian TV series is based on, you realize that there's some fucking real criminals, some real career gangsters in mainland Europe that aren't to do with anything to do with the John Gottes and all those kind of people over there in America and stuff, right? These are some real, real people who kind of get, who do the actual work, right? And actually have some very outlandish ways of doing things, or very movie-like way of doing things. So it makes you wonder, maybe Quentin Tarantino's kind of guys are plugged into European news and stuff, and they kind of base those movies on some of the exploits of these guys. Because you don't really hear those stories in America, right? Of like big jewelry heist thief gangs storming in, bursting into places. Like, what was that gang on mopeds in France who kind of took all those jewelry within like a matter of seconds, right? It was kind of clinical. They kind of jumped in scooters and come in and smashed loads of windows and went out. So yeah, I'm hoping Quentin Tarantino sees this story and makes a movie of it, because my God, it's going to be amazing, man. Fucking amazing. Big up Rédoine Faïd. Stay out of prison, brother. What else is on the docket? What do you guys think of the... Actually, you know what? What's the final verdict on the Kanye Wyoming projects? Having listened to... I don't know, like... It's hard... let's see. It's sort of hard to judge everything now, especially with all the other news that we heard coming about, right? We've heard there's been some weird developments since Kanye's Wyoming project, or those projects in general. So you had Teyana Taylor, Kanye project, Kanye and Kid Cudi, Nas and King and Pusha T. So five projects overall. It's hard to judge it all now, especially with all the backstory, right? You got the Drake Pusha T, you've got the Kanye Drake, you've got the Drake Kanye. You've got loads of stuff happening in the background that sort of kind of skews it. But I think musically or creatively, I think it was a real testament, a real sound, an alert to creatives all around the world that, you know, you can do what you want if you really want to, right? You can kind of push yourself, because he did what? Like those things in a month, right? So he did like 35 beats in a month, all original stuff. So obviously, a lot of it sample heavy, but you know, he went from a place, if you watch the interview with Zane Lowe, where he's kind of ranting and raving about fashion, he went from a place where he's getting annoyed and fed up that everyone tells him just stick to music and concentrate on fashion, to go into a place where, you know, where he seems like he wasn't necessarily in love with it anymore, to go into a place where he's making 35 beats and plus for his friends, right? So it was a very important moment in time. And I think for, regardless if you're a fan of Kanye or not, I think it's great to see someone of his level, an artist on his stature, on his platform, be able to take that level of risk and be like, you know what, I don't care. I'm going to try my, I don't care if this fails or it doesn't fail, or if it fails or flops. I want to experiment, have some fun with my friends and make music that we all enjoy, right? So he kind of went away and did the same thing he did with the Hawaii, but instead went to Wyoming, renting out this log cabin somewhere in the mountains, snow everywhere, and flew in all these different people to come and work on these amazing albums. And it seems like artistically or creatively, for me personally, I think my favorite of all of these of the whole rollout have to be Teyana Taylor's. And only because they sound the most complete, right? Teyana Taylor, the Kid Cudi Ghost, the Kanye and Kid Cudi one, Pusha T, obviously, and that'll probably be about it. Those three are the ones that kind of stand out for me personally. The others did Nas and whatever, and the Kanye self-titled, I wasn't really that much of a fan of. But again, I'll be interested to see. I don't think anyone's gonna repeat this template, because I think, as good as the albums were, or as good as they could have been, I still think if you're going to do an album that's seven tracks long, I would much rather, or I think the public would much rather, they just be seven bangers as opposed to trying to make an album that's seven songs long. Because then you end up, it just doesn't sound right. Like you have bits of interludes in there. It just doesn't work that well, in my opinion. But then the argument could be said that sometimes customers don't know what a hit is until... that hear it on an album full of tracks, right? So if you have an album that's 10 albums, that's 10 tracks long, it's not necessarily easy to find out what a track, what a hit is, right? But I disagree in some respects, because MGMT was a good example, right? MGMT's first album, what album was that? Let's see MGMT discography, because I remember going back to that thinking, you know what, that album wasn't that long, but it was fucking full of absolute bangers. So that's the one, Ocular Spectacular, right? Oracular Spectacular, right? So let's go for their discography, and you can see now that even though studio album, there you go. Oracular Spectacular, right? This is MGMT's first album that came out in 2007, and it's 10 tracks long, right? So you got time. These are all bad, in my opinion. This is an era where, you know, the whole indie wave was sort of dying down, and these guys kind of came back out and rose like phoenixes, right? So, and the album got nearly 4 or 5 out of 5 stars and everything. So it goes from track one. Actually, let me put it up on the screen so you guys can see. So it goes, Time to Pretend, right? Weekend Warriors, number 2. Free You, 4 Electric Feel, 5 Kids, 4 Fourth Dimension Transition, Pieces of War, and it probably falls off only by 8. But so far, you've got bangers, 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 bangers. So I think if you're Kanye or if you're at that camp and you're going to make those albums, it might be advantageous to probably just have 7 bangers as opposed to like, or maybe just, sorry, have 10 tracks. And of the 10 tracks, 7 be bangers, as opposed to 7 tracks, and of the 7, only 3 or 4 be bangers. Because even though I like The Kids See Ghosts, even though I like Keep the Same Energy by Tiana Taylor, even though I like Pusha T's Daytona, I'm still only playing 4 tracks out of them, right? Maybe 3 to 4, let's say, track, which probably isn't enough still for a 7-track album. But like I said, I think creatively for everyone around the world to see that, you know, it's possible to do, to create this much amazing music and also put it out in this really innovative way, I think was really cool. You know, these sort of listening parties outside where they turn them into concerts, I just think that's some real god level shit in general. I think it's quite amazing to see them go for it. I think for the music purists out there, maybe it's a little, there's too much fluff, there's too many backflips involved, you know, that are kind of distracting you from the actual music itself, some would argue it. But I think if you can marry up having great music and do that kind of a rollout, you'll be on to an absolute winner. And obviously the merch too. Everyone bar probably Tiana Taylor got some good merch. Tiana Taylor's merch was fucking garbage. I don't know who designed that for her. It seems like she kind of got a bit of the rough end of the stick, didn't she? Like Kanye had to come back to New York after the Virgil show to kind of attend her show, her listening party. The album sounded different from the snippets other people heard because some of the samples didn't get cleared. The merch sound looked a bit shitty. I don't know. Tiana Taylor probably deserved a bit better than everyone else. I think Tiana Taylor probably needed a good album from that rollout than anyone else, right? She probably needed it more. Maybe her and Kid Cudi, considering how bad people thought his last album was, right? Shooting Star to the Moon or whatever that one was called. The one with his guitar where he's kind of leaning backwards. But overall, I thought it was good, a good rollout. I'm a fan of it. I'm still playing a lot of the music now at the moment. And we should see what happens now on the post Wyoming project, because we got news now that's come out that supposedly Drake played March 14th to Kanye before Pusha T recorded his verse for Infrared, which then led to Pusha T finding out all the extra info about Drake supposedly having a kid that he was hiding. So now it looks as if, because I remember a lot of people were saying that, why was Drake going so hard at Kanye during Dappy Freestyle, considering how hard Pusha went directly at Drake. And now it goes to show that Drake doesn't really have a problem with Pusha T. Pusha T is sort of like collateral damage because, you know, he's Kanye's mate. But he's real problems with Kanye because Kanye, quote unquote, snitched on him, right? Which I guess if you're Kanye, you're going to say you didn't, because you're probably closer to Pusha T than you are to Drake, and you probably your loyalty is to Pusha. You know what I mean? Like maybe it's a bit naive of Kanye to think Kanye wasn't. Maybe it's a bit naive of Drake to think Kanye wasn't going to go and tell Pusha T. But it's interesting to see what's going to happen post this whole news, how people kind of perceive the whole albums overall. But it seems like from the time Kanye put that MAGA hat on, a lot of people have sort of like given up hope on Kanye in general anyway. So I think some people are just kind of, you know, are happy to see him kind of fizzle out into the background, which is sad to see really considering his talent, but hey ho, what can it go? Like I said, creatively, I think for everyone, we've all kind of won in that respect by seeing someone like Kanye take such a risk, I think, by putting out these albums, doing them in such a way, you know, no fade outs that he mentions on the track. I thought it was an interesting way to kind of go about making an album in general, I think, anyway, personally. But like I said, still at the rollout, I'm still banging Daytona, I'm still banging Keep the Same Energy and Kids See Ghost, and that's about it really from all of it. But hey, that's still not that, that's probably all right for the most part. But yeah, that's probably about an hour, I think, right, so far for the podcast. Might be a good place to end it so I can start getting ready for my day. This has been the Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 81. Thanks again for listening and hanging out with your kid. It's been amazing. As I said, it's coming home. Football's fucking coming home. I can't wait. England are going to play on Wednesday. Really looking forward to that game. Today's Tuesday. Whatever you're doing during the week, I hope you do it diligently and you put your head down and you get cracking with what you need to get cracking with. For more information regarding yours truly, regarding DJ dates or all that other stuff that you might be interested in, like, oh, what's this guy actually do? All that sort of bullshit. Check out my website at agostinozinga.com for more information. That's agostinozinga.com. I'll link that on the show notes. And I'll see you again later in the week for another episode of the Agostinho Zinga Show. I've been your host. It's been good talking. And let's speak again very, very soon. Peace.